I'm giving the sermon today, and I would like to thank Chip. Most of these are his words with a little bit of editing from me, so please pray with me. Dear Jesus, you are the hope in our messy world. This Advent season, help us to slow down, listen to your voice, and focus on what is really important. We place our hope in you as we prepare our hearts to celebrate your birth on Christmas. Amen. What in the world is today's gospel text from Luke? It certainly doesn't evoke thoughts of Christmas. So what in the world is going on here? This biblical text is filled with words that conjure up thoughts of disaster. And God knows we have been dealing with a lot of disaster lately. Where are the wonderful godlike words of revelation? Most of us associate very specific sights and sounds with Christmas. Some people may envision a favorite ornament to hang on the Christmas tree, while others think of a cherished toy always displayed at this time of the year. Whatever the specifics, most of the images of Christmas that fill our minds involve rich colors, fine fabrics, sparkling stars, favorite foods, glittering ornaments, shimmering tinsel, and beautiful lights. But there is another side to the season, a different view of Christmas. For some people, Christmas looks dull and sparse rather than sparkling and rich, rugged rather than polished, dark rather than light, futile rather than festive. Here is the critical question: can the truth of Christmas be experienced without any of the festive symbols of the season? What kind of preparations must be made? What kind of decorations must be displayed in order for Jesus to enter our lives, to be God with us? Grasping for correct answers to these questions is crucial to understanding the meaning of the season. From the perspective of the Holy Scriptures, Advent, the coming of Christ, is much more about disorder than about order. You see, God's visitation to earth is not contingent upon burning candles or shimmering stars. Look at Luke's message. The gospel writer used words and images that seem to have nothing to do with the advent of Jesus in order to declare that these very words and images and the harsh conditions that they suggest should be viewed as sure signs that the advent of Jesus is imminent. Decorations that adorn the seasons of Advent and Christmas signal a celebration, a spirit of joy, an explosion of happiness, an eruption of beauty to honor the Christ who comes to give glory to God. As a means of response to Advent and Christmas events, decorations are in order. And some people say, the more the better, the more glorious, the more appropriate. But must everything be beautiful for Jesus Christ to be born? God help us if that is the case. Look at the text from Luke. The worst conditions may hold the greatest promise of the nearness of God in our midst. The arrival of Jesus Christ is not stopped by scenes of homeless, hungry children, lines of refugees marching up from South America, floods on the East Coast, fires in California, wet and difficult harvests, and blizzards in Minnesota. Indeed, God invades the ugliest situations in life as well as the most glorious. Every year during Advent, I hear some people say, I have so much to get done before Christmas, I don't believe I'm gonna be ready. Christmas can't come yet, I don't have my house decorated, I don't have my food prepared, and I don't have my presents bought. We would do well to listen to ourselves as well as we listen to Luke. A subtle misunderstanding pervades the attitudes reflected in the following comment. Christmas comes most meaningfully to those who have prepared for it most lavishly. Well, I tell you, no. God's entrance into our lives occurs in God's time and according to his plan. Christ arrives in our midst not as a reward for our preparations, but as a result of God's divine compassion. God comes to us whether or not we have thoroughly prepared for his arrival. The success of Christmas is not contingent on how well we have decorated for the event. God comes to us amid darkness and despair, just as readily as amid light and happiness. You see, Christmas is an expression of God's grace. Pastor Chip told me about an essay focused on that biblical phrase from Galatians, when the fullness of time had come, God sent his son. The writer skillfully made the point that Jesus was born when the world was fully prepared. He wrote of the unification of the world under Roman peace, the value of new avenues of travel and communication for spreading the word from Bethlehem about the Bethlehem event, a right moment in the international economy, a moral and spiritual readiness for the revelation. The conclusion of the author was that from the beginning of time, God had been waiting for people to get the conditions of the world and the sentiments of their souls just right so that Jesus could appear on earth. But I think the author was wrong. Jesus' arrival in the world did not depend on the world having everything ready for his divine revelation to occur. Then and now, God shows up in our lives not in response to our preparations, but out of mercy and grace that is in response to the immense needs of humankind. On this third Sunday in Advent, please be freed from the notion that the success or failure of Christmas rests upon us. Now I'm going to cry a little bit. Christ's arrival is not about our decorations, but about revelation. Not about perfect conditions, but about God's compassion. Excuse me. The advent of Jesus is nothing less than the revelation of God's incredible love for all people, whatever their situations or social conditions. If you have been able to decorate your yard with nativity scenes, hang wreaths or decorate trees, and display lights to celebrate Christ's birth, great. But if your days are completely lacking of joy and your home is stark and sparse, if your life seems to be in the shreds of ugliness rather than beautiful and joyful, no matter. Again, dear people, Christ will still come to you. Christmas will still arrive in your life. Read again the stories about God in the Gospels. God is not partial to the best clothes or impressed by any form of extravagance. God's grace ignores prerequisites. The God who joined the world in a smelly cattle stall somewhere down a back street in a little-known village called Bethlehem arrives where no lights blink and no flags fly, in hospital wards as well as in cathedrals, among mourners as well as among carolers. God comes where everything seems to be ending and lost, as well as where everything appears to be beginning and new. Let us be done with any thought that the success or failure of Christmas depends upon how we get ready. Neither a gala nor a concert, neither a banquet nor a finely decorated tree is a prerequisite to Christ's coming among us. Christmas is not about God's response to our needs. Christmas is about God's response to our needs, not God's reaction to our decorations or party plans. The Christ who has come will come. Christ will come among us. Let us open our hearts and make him welcome. Amen. Thank you.
Amen.